to Mariology. This is Dr. Mark Miravalli. My friends, in this lecture, we're going to examine the revelation of Mary in light of what we call the sources of divine revelation. Now, before we get into that specifically, I want to identify the two extremes that are possible with the study of Mary. St. Thomas Aquinas rightly tells us that we want to avoid what's called excess, on one hand too much, and defect, on the other hand too little. This is also the teachings of the Second Vatican Council, Lumen Gentium, number 67. So what would be Mary in excess, too much about Mary, and what would be too little, Mary in defect? Well, let's start with the excess. Whenever we're talking about Mary in excess, this leads to any concept, any thought that Mary is a divine being. And of course, we immediately identify that as both blasphemy and heresy. Any idea that Mary is anything close to a fourth person of the Trinity is a violation of the truth revealed in Scripture and tradition, and as we'll discuss today, as protected and interpreted by the church's magisterium. So, for example, there was an alleged apparition of Mary, which posed that the false visionary said, yes, Mary and I make up together the fourth person of the Trinity. Well, that's an easy one to discern, right, my friends? Because that's obviously false. That's obviously excessive. It's extreme. And also, I would hold nothing hurts the Immaculate Heart of Mary more than when she's put in competition with her son rather than the servant of her son. Even biblically, and as the fathers talk about, Mary is the moon that reflects the light that comes from the sun. She's not the source of the light, but she's the perfect immaculate reflection of that light. So any idea that to deify Mary, to adore Mary, is pleasing to her would be antithetical to the truth. There was, for example, in the early church, a heresy called the Coloridians. And the Coloridians were a group of women who thought they were priests and they would offer Mass to Mary in adoration. This was very quickly and completely condemned by the church. So the first extreme is, again, to have Mary enter the Trinity as if she is a divine person. False, dangerous, and that which is to be rejected entirely. The second extreme we call Marian defect. And Marian defect, again, is to minimize. In other words, to fail to testify to the full truth of who Mary is. What's an example of minimizing the truth about Mary? Well, for example, anything that falls short of what the magisterium of the church teaches about her. And again, we'll go through the relationship between Scripture, tradition, as interpreted by the magisterium. But a case of Marian defect would be that Mary was, for example, just a good disciple. Or even that she's the best disciple, but she's not your mother. She's not my mother. She is only a physical channel, a human physical channel by which God deigned that Jesus would get his human nature, and now she can be pushed off to the side almost like a surrogate mother. These are all forms of Marian defect. Now, ultimately, we have to ask the question, how do we know? How do we know what is excess or defect? And the answer is, of course, the teachings of the church. For the Catholic, and again, we'll enter this discussion shortly, for the Catholic, the sources of divine revelation in specific Scripture and tradition, as interpreted by the magisterium, is what identifies for us the truth, the golden mean, what is authentically, doctrinally, and ontologically true about the mother of Jesus. So this calls us into a discussion of the sources of divine revelation. So in this lecture and in the following lecture, we're going to go through these sources as it's taught by the church. And in particular, we're going to be taking our material from, and you're free to read along, it's an outstanding work, not the whole thing, you can certainly do that as well. I don't want to scare those holding up a big, thick book such as this. These are, of course, the documents of the Second Vatican Council. But a document within these great works, these inspired, these works protected by the Spirit as an ecumenical council, is the document Dei Verbum, Dogmatic Constitution on Divine Revelation. Dei Verbum, the Word of God. So we're going to be summarizing Dei Verbum in our lecture today. You're, of course, free to read it on your own. You can go to the Vatican website, for example, and just read it off that if you'd like. Now, as we go through this discussion, I want us to be clear about how important this issue is. We're really asking, where is God's will found? Where do we search to examine the truth about God, Jesus, Mary, the church? And so this is a quintessentially important discussion for any theological topic. And so as we go through this, my friends, I'd ask you to keep this question in the back of your minds, and perhaps in the forefront at times as well. And it's the understandable question that many Protestant Christians have about Catholic teaching and Catholic belief regarding Mary. And the question is usually posed in this way, and I want to say as a foundation for all this course, anytime we bring up our brothers and sisters in Christ, our true brothers and sisters, who are not Catholic, who are not in the full communion, we do so in total respect and love. We never imply or make an act of judgment of the heart, but in honesty and integrity and really in authentic ecumenical activity, we must discuss the differences. That's authentic dialogue based on authentic truth. So it is oftentimes the case that the Protestant Christian asks the Catholic Christian the question, where is Mary in the Bible? Or even more specifically, where are dogmas like the Immaculate Conception or the Assumption or Our Lady's Perpetual Virginity? Where are those found in the Bible? And what's implied there, my friends, and that's why it's so important that we start this course on Our Lady discussing the sources of divine revelation, it's so important that we realize that both the Bible and also the church teach that all of revelation is not contained only in the Bible. So this will be a critical foundation for our discussion about Mary, because otherwise some would say, well, where does it explicitly teach that Mary is immaculately conceived? And oftentimes the Catholic Christian has feels a sense of tongue-tied and a temptation to Bible thump different passages, when it really begs the question, what is the true source of revelation? Many years back, two members from the Jehovah Witness came to my front door, and they started with the question, you know, are you concerned about the state of the world? And I responded, well, can you tell me where you believe God's will is revealed? And they came back as they were trained, and look, you have to appreciate their personal diligence and commitment to do door-by-door evangelization. It's tough to do. But in a real sense, until we got to the question, where do you think God's will is revealed, our exchanges would be rather superficial. Well, ultimately, the two gentlemen said, well, we believe the Watchtower magazine is the source of revelation. I said, well, then come on in. Now we have something to talk about, because then we could talk about the historic errors that were contained in the Watchtower magazine, the many times that they predicted the end of the world and whatnot. But the point is, that should always be our first question in an honest dialogue and debate. Where do you think God's will is found? And that's why this lecture has to be the foundation for everything else we talk about regarding Our Lady. So once again, in the forefront or in the background or in the back of your mind, as we're going through this, entertain the question of a well-intended Protestant Christian, why do you Catholics hold so much about Mary? Why do you revere her so much when it's not explicitly in the Bible? And that key word is explicit. So let's keep that as a foundation as we now go through the sources of divine revelation. So once again, taken from the Second Vatican Council, the document on the dogmatic constitution of divine revelation, De Verbum, the Second Vatican Council tells us that there's a one twinfold source of God revealing his will to humanity. Well, what does that mean, one twinfold source? It means it's really one unified source with two essential aspects or facets. What are those two facets? First of all, it talks about sacred tradition. Secondly, it talks about, and rightly so, sacred scripture. So let's talk about sacred tradition first. Why? Because both ontologically in itself and also historically, as we're going to see, sacred tradition comes first. Now, let's define our terms. Many Catholics would struggle if they were put upon to give an accurate definition of sacred tradition. Not just things passed down in papal closets, not just things of history which we've kind of taken on. It has a supernatural and a critically important distinction and contribution to who we are as members of the Church of Jesus Christ. So the Second Vatican Council, Dei Verbum, will define sacred tradition as the truths of Christ passed orally, handed down to the apostles and their successors under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Okay, so let's examine that again. These are the truths of Jesus passed on orally, also in things that he did, things that he instituted, or that which the Holy Spirit inspired the apostles to do, which is passed on, traditio, that's what the word means, to hand down, to pass further down, under the Holy Spirit's protection of the apostles and their successors. Well, who are the successors of the apostles? Well, that would be, again, the Pope and bishops in union with the Pope. So note, my friends, historically, sacred tradition comes first. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean that Jesus establishes his gospel, he reveals his gospel, he establishes his church first in an oral, experiential fashion with the apostles. Now, I want to begin with this comment, and please don't take it as in any way sarcastic or presumptive in terms of the beauty of what we're going to be talking about. But we should start by very clearly stating, historically, Jesus did not start his church, or Jesus did not reveal his gospel by having a divine book dropped from heaven or brought down by an angel with a golden binding and an apostle discovered it and said, oh, well, this is how the church has to be. This is how God has revealed himself. He could have done that, I suppose. Jesus just did not. He starts the church, the living, breathing, dynamic church, by a personal experience of him to the apostles. And the power of the Holy Spirit protects that they receive it correctly. And as we're going to see, several of them, both apostles and disciples, will write it down, but they're going to be writing down that tradition which is given them by Jesus and which is inspired and protected by the Holy Spirit. Let me make a reference of Scripture here and then talk about a historical dimension. Let's go to John 21. Okay. Verses 24 and 25. This is the very end of John's gospel. And this is how St. John ends the last gospel. He says, and I quote, "There are, however, many other things that Jesus did, but if every one of these should be written, not even the world itself, I think, could hold the books that would have to be written." Now, what a somewhat unusual way to end a gospel. He's ending the gospel by saying, there's so many other things that Jesus did that are not contained in these written gospels. Now, of course, one can't run amok with that idea and think, well, it could be everything, including, sadly, what Joseph Smith said was part of Revelation in the 19th century. No, we know that by the death of John, the last apostle, that's the end of what we call public revelation. Okay? So there's no new doctrines revealed after the death of John. But why does John make reference to the other things that Jesus did? Well, because 3 years of being with the God-man, day and night, praying, living, weeping, evangelizing, there's no way that that could be contained in 25 pages or 30 pages or several hundred pages. And that's why John says the whole world couldn't hold the books that would have to be written. That points, my friends, that's a biblical reference pointing to tradition, a body that goes beyond the written word, but from which the written word is drawn. So apostles and disciples, of course, the four, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are inspired by the Spirit to write down under the Spirit in an inerrant way what is happening and what Jesus reveals. But the idea that Scripture is the only source of revelation is, quite frankly, non-scriptural. Nowhere in Scripture does it say that Scripture is the only source. In fact, 2 Thessalonians 2 says, make sure to hand on the tradition, hand on what has been handed down. Now, let me make reference to the following historical note. 34 AD. Now, by 34 AD, I'm making reference to a year after the passion, death, and resurrection of Jesus. I'm not so much concerned with the historical accuracy of exactly when Jesus ascended. This is more of a theological historical point. So let's talk about 1 year after the passion, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Well, what do we have in that 1 year? What's taking place in a year after Jesus ascends? Well, do we have a living, breathing, dynamic church that if you're a member, you will obtain salvation? Sure. Most all Christians will grant that. Do we have any sacraments? Sure. Jesus has given the call, the mandate to baptize. This is Matthew 28:19. Baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That's his resurrected message to the apostles, and they're certainly doing that. Do we have the Eucharist? Well, sure, we have Emmaus, right? Jesus was seen in the breaking of the bread. And to have the Eucharist, we also have to have priesthood, clearly in the form of the apostles. So 1 year after Jesus dies and rises, we have a living, breathing, saving church. And if you die, even the early martyrs would testify to this, if you die in belief of that first revelation, which comes through tradition, you would be saved. Well, what's the point? Why are we bringing up 34 AD? Because let me tell you what's not present in 34 AD, my friends. What's not present in 34 AD is the New Testament. In fact, quite frankly, it's not even close. Scripture scholars will estimate that the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians could be written somewhere between 49 and 51, but you don't have a gospel written yet, and you won't even have the canon, that is, the combined inspired writings which make up the New Testament, you won't even have that confirmed to the end of the 4th century, and then ultimately confirmed, that's from the Council of Hippo somewhere in the 390s, as presided by St. Augustine, and it's not confirmed by a pope until 401 with Pope Innocent. So the point is, sacred tradition comes first. And that's why, my friends, if you want to properly interpret what is then written from that oral, living, saving church and the tradition from which it comes, you have to properly interpret the text in light of the tradition, in light of the family from which the child comes, if you will, the child being analogous to the different letters, the Gospels, the text, St. Paul's didactic teaching. So our first point is that sacred tradition comes first. And this reference to 34 AD is not to in any way undermine the importance, the beauty, the sublimity of Scripture, but it's to say, remember, we had a church as instituted by Jesus before we had the New Testament. So let's go to the second aspect of this one twinfold aspect of revelation. In other words, how God reveals himself. First, it's through tradition, and secondly, as Dave Arum speaks about, it is through Scripture. Now, Scripture is defined by Dave Arum as the, quote, speech of God as it is put down in writing under the breath of the Holy Spirit. And we know we're talking about divinely revealed truths written down under the power of the Holy Spirit and the protection of the Holy Spirit in both Old and New Testaments. These writings, my friends, are inerrant, meaning that there is no doctrinal error in these writings. It is protected by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so, in proper understanding of this, we see that Scripture, which has to have a certain revered place within tradition, is nonetheless part of tradition. The living, breathing, dynamic, saving mission of the church, protected from error by the Holy Spirit. Now, let me say a few quick words about the relationship between Scripture and tradition. And let's specify, for the sake of precision, the relationship between Scripture and the New Testament. First of all, as we've established, sacred tradition came first with the oral living gospel as embodied and protected by the church. Again, it's important that we realize it doesn't first come from a book. It first comes from a body from which the book then beautifully and supernaturally emerges. And that's why it's fair to say that tradition in the church is the mother from which the child, the New Testament, comes forward. So first of all, sacred tradition comes first in the oral, living, and protected gospel and tradition and mission of salvation. Secondly, it's important to note that historically, it was the church that selected which of all the early Christian writings would become part of the New Testament, but also importantly, which ones would not. So for example, it was a call to distinguish between an inspirational writing in the early church versus an inspired writing. Well, it was the church who made this discernment. As I mentioned before, St. Athanasius came up with what was called the canon in the middle part of the 4th century, but he does so as a bishop, but not with the full authority of the church. It's later at the Council of Hippo, either in 392, 397, in that period, and then it's confirmed by the Holy Father, which is necessary for a confirmation, a papal confirmation of this truth. And so the point is, it was difficult to sort out which of all the early Christian writings would really be the New Testament. The logic, therefore, calls us to say, if you accept the New Testament as divinely inspired, then you necessarily, logically, would accept the authority of the church that selected it as such. It wasn't popularity. It wasn't common consensus, because certain local writings had more of an appreciation than others. It was the Holy Spirit guiding the early church authority to choose the New Testament. And that's why we can say, in a certain sense, it's illogical to hold that the New Testament is divinely inspired and at the same time to reject the authority of the church which selected it as such. And that's why, as the Second Vatican Council says so well, Scripture and tradition make up one sacred deposit of the Word of God entrusted to the church. And I just want to read to you, in summary and in conclusion of this lecture, why that's so important. So this is Dei Verbum number 9, and the Council Fathers say, quote, "Sacred tradition and sacred Scripture, then, are bound closely together and communicate one with the other. For both of them, flowing out from the same divine wellspring, come together in some fashion to form one thing and move towards the same goal. Sacred Scripture is the speech of God as it is put down in writing under the breath of the Holy Spirit. And tradition transmits in its entirety the Word of God, which has been entrusted to the apostles by Christ the Lord and the Holy Spirit. It transmits to it to the successors of the apostles so that, enlightened by the Spirit of truth, they may faithfully persevere, expound, and spread it abroad by their teaching. Thus it comes about that the church does not draw her certainty about all revealed truth from Holy Scripture alone. Hence, both Scripture and tradition must be accepted and honored with equal feeling of devotion and reverence." So that last line again. "Hence, both Scripture and tradition must be accepted and honored with equal feelings of devotion and reverence." So you might be asking at the end of this first lecture, okay, what does this have to do with Our Lady? What does it have to do with Mary? Well, we're going to see in the next lecture that only a proper understanding of divine revelation as both Scripture and tradition will give us the full truth about Mary. And that will bring us to the answer to the question, why do Catholics believe so much about Mary if it's not explicitly in Scripture? As you just heard, it's because Scripture is not the only source of revelation. And in fact, if you want to be true to Scripture and the beauty and sublimity of Scripture, you have to interpret Scripture from the mother, from the family, from the tradition from which it comes. Thanks for being with us in this lecture of Mariology. We hope that you will tune into the next lecture as well. This is Dr. Mark Miravalli saying God bless you, and let's always remember the words of Jesus, to behold your mother. Thanks.